A warm welcome to all. In this session, we are going to discuss about Tinea and its species. Parasitology is broadly classified into two types, protozoans and helminthus. Helminthus are the multicellular organisms which are bilaterally symmetrical, which is further subdivided into platyhelminthus and nematohelminthus. In platyhelminthus, which is a leaf-like shape or a tape-like shape, are subdivided into cestoidea and trematoda. Under cestoids, Tinea saginata, solium, echinococcus granulosus, etc. will come under this group. In trematodes, Fasciola hepatica, Fasciolopsis buscae, Paragonimus westermanni, and so on. And in nematohelminthus, which is cylindrical and elongated in shape, will have only one class, which is nematoda. And under this, we'll be having Entrobius vermicularis, Wuchereria bancrofti, Ascaris lumbricoides, and so on. So these three classes will have, we are going to discuss about their shapes, sexes, etc. So in cestodes, which I've already told you, that is tape-like shape and segmented in nature, whereas trematodes and nematodes are unsegmented in nature. The sexes are not separate in cestodes, that is monoecious. In trematodes, except cestosomes, all are monoecious. Whereas in nematodes, it is dioecious, which means it is they are having a separate sexes. Head suckers often with hooks are present. Whereas in the case of trematodes, suckers are present but not hooks. Whereas in nematodes, no suckers and no hooks. Alimentary canal is totally absent in cestodes, whereas in trematodes, it is present, but it is incomplete and no anus. Whereas in nematodes, the alimentary canal is present and complete, and anus is also present. The body cavity is not there in cestodes and trematodes, whereas in nematodes, it is present. Now, we are going to discuss about the Tinea. So the Tinea, it comes under the order Cyclophyllidean cestodes, family Tineidae, genus Tinea, species Tinea saginata and Tinea solium. The general characters of the Tinea species. So the similarity between the Tinea saginata and the solium is both are a tapeworm and it is worldwide in distribution, and the adult worm lives in the small intestine of the man, which is in the upper jejunum, and they move against the peristaltic movement in the host intestine, and it is semi-transparent in nature. This Tinea saginata is also called as beef tapeworm or unarmed tapeworm, and it is particularly seen in Mohammedans who consumes beef. This Tinea solium is also called as pork tapeworm or armed tapeworm of man. It is not seen in Jews like saginata, but it is seen in other communities. Since the Mohammedans and Jews will not, generally they are not a pork eaters. So this is the adult worm of Tinea saginata and Tinea solium. So when we are going to discuss about their head, it is quadrate in outline and they have four circular suckers. The head with no rostrum or hooklet seen. Neck is long and it is fragile in nature. And the proglottids, the segments are 1000 to 2000. And the gravid segments, they are having central longitudinal sim, which is having 15 to 30 lateral branches on each side. And the segments will expel singly. And the lifespan of this saginata is 10 years. Whereas in the case of Tinea solium adult worm, the scolex, you can see the head portion, it is globular in outline and it has four circular suckers, the head with rostellum and two rows of alternating large and small hooklets, and the neck is very short. You can see the proglottid segments containing 800 to 900. The gravid uterus, in the case of Solium, it is median longitudinal stem having 5 to 10 lateral branches. The segments are expelled passively, 5 to 6 at a time, and their lifespan is about 25 years. This is an expanded view where you can see the alternating rows of the hooklets. And this is in the case of Taenia serginata without rostellum or hooklets. This is an uterine branch comparison, which I have told you, this gravid uterus containing a median longitudinal stem in the case of Solium with 5 to 10 lateral branches. Whereas here, in the case of serginata, they are having central longitudinal stem with 15 to 30 lateral branches. The egg, which you can see over here, will not float in the saturated solution of the common salt, and they will be having a transparent shell, and it is consisting of embryophore, which is having three pairs of hooklets. So now we'll move on to the life cycle. So the definitive host is human being. The adult worm lives in the human host, okay, human as a host. Whereas in the intermediate host is nothing but the cow or buffalo in the case of Taenia serginata, pork in the case of Taenia solium. They harbor the larval stage. So the larval stage of Taenia serginata is Cysticercus bovis, whereas in the case of Solium, it is Cysticercus cellulose. So now we'll move on to the life cycle. So the Taenia solium, either in Taenia solium or the Taenia serginata, the same life cycle, except they will be having a different intermediate host. So in the case of cattle, it is Taenia serginata, whereas in the case of pigs, it is Taenia solium. So when the eggs or segments passed out with the feces in the ground, the animals, while grazing, they will be swallowing these eggs. So once they swallow these eggs, they will reach out the alimentary canal where the eggs get liberated, and they enter the gut wall by hooks through portal vessels or mesenteric lymphatics. So via portal vein, that is liver, they will enter into the right side of the heart, then to the lungs, and then to the left side of the heart. Finally, they will reach the systemic circulation. And the oncospheres will start settling down in the muscular tissues, that is in the soft tissues, such as tongue, neck, shoulder, ham. Sometimes cardiac muscle will also be involved. So once they get settled down, the cells in the center start liquefying, and after 8 days of infection, the oncospheres will form an oval vesicle and starts increasing in size. And then they contain at its bottom a larvae. So from the oncosphere to form a cysticercae, it will take about 60 to 70 days for them to metamorphose. And then the humans got an infection by ingesting the raw or undercooked infected meat. So once it enters inside the alimentary canal, then they will be digested in the bile, and the scolex will exvaginate, and they anchor the gut wall with the help of the suckers, and then start gradual sterilization. Then it sexually matures within 2 to 3 months, where it start producing the eggs, where the cycle continues. So you can see either eggs or gravid proglottids in the feces, which is passed on to the environment. So this is all about the life cycle. And this is an adult worm. You can see the size in the small intestine. And this is the scolex, which we already discussed. So the larval stage is nothing but the Cysticercus bovis, that is Taenia serginata, which develop in the muscles of cow or buffalo. And this larval stage will not occur in human beings. Whereas Cysticercus cellulose, which is a Taenia solium larval stage, it develops in the muscles of egg, a dense milk white spot at the site where scolex and with hooks and suckers gets invaginated. And this stage, occasionally, you can see them in the human beings. The eggs of Taenia species. And here you cannot differentiate between the eggs of Taenia solium and the Taenia saginata. And as I told you already, these eggs will not float in the saturated solution of common salt, and they will be having a transparent shell. Okay, can you see this? Yes, this is a represent the remnants of the yolk mass. And you can see the embryophore, which is thick brown in color, and it also contains an oncosphere with three pairs of hooklets inside. Okay, and you can see this this Taenia solium rostellar hooklets, which we have seen in the case of adult worm. Yes, this, it looks like a Arabian bonnet, or you can see it is shaped like a daggers. And this is all about the eggs of the Taenia species. It is not useful for the differentiation between the species. So only the head will help you in differentiating the species. So pathogenicity, adult worms usually will not show any symptoms, but rarely it may lead to abdominal discomfort, chronic indigestion, anemia, intestinal disorders, diarrhea, constipation, etc. These are the symptoms that you can see. Whereas in the larvae, which I have told you, like where you can see them very rarely, that is by drinking any contaminated water and uncooked vegetables. Autoinfection, maybe this is, or by reversal peristaltic movement of intestine. So autoinfection is usually due to unhygienic practices. And this reversal peristaltic movement, which is nothing but this gravy segments will be thrown back to the stomach, which is equivalent to swallow thousands of eggs. So that was the main thing where this will lead to a great problem. So in the larval stage, the infection, as I told you, by drinking contaminated water, which may develop in any organ. The effect produced depends on the location where the cystis cercae is situated. In the subcutaneous tissues or in the muscles, it will be seen as a palpable or visible nodule. In brain, it may lead to an epileptic attack. Lab diagnosis, the stool sample is taken for the macroscopic point of view. You can see a whitish segments on the yellow feces. Or if you want to screen for the head region, then we have to treat them with the anti-helminthic. Microscopically, we can take the smear of the feces, okay, a direct smear from the feces sample, or we can concentrate them with any low-density solutions. NIH swab, which is used for enterobiosis, will also helpful in this case sometimes. The head and the gravy segments are the important one in species diagnosis. The larval stage, cystis cercus cellulose, the neurocystis cercosis can be detected either by serodiagnosis, ELISA, or computed tomography of scan, a scan of brain, or MRI scan. Detection in the eye by ophthalmic examination. Roentgenograms of skull and soft tissues reveal calcified cystis cercae. So treatment, praziquantel, albendazole. For cerebral cystis cercosis, hetirizin is the drug of choice. Prophylaxis, which is very much important for the prevention and control of the disease. So we should have a proper sanitary control of sewage disposal, and good hygienic practices should be maintained. We should avoid undercooked meat, and there should be an adequate inspection in the slaughterhouse. Thank you.